to A-level physics.
With this book, OCR. Absolutely. Right at the beginning of the course, there's some really, really big tables there.
Really big tables, yeah, horrifically big tables. You've got to know them all.
You've got to know everything. I can't really teach you because it's the tables.
We're just going to draw the table. Even though it's in your book, we're just going to draw it anyway.
So we'll do it a bit faster. We're really good at writing quickly, ready?
Ready?
Okay, I'll warm up. All right, you're doing this. You start.
Start with.
One table.
Gotta know it.
Yeah, gotta know all of that.
You gotta know what all of these are.
All of those
units
are. An abbreviation. You gotta use them because then you gotta use them in different amounts of them. That brings us to the second table, which is relative sizes.
So let's get on.
Let's get on with it.
Round two. Another table.
Table.
Again, you've got to know it, got to know it by heart. Bigger than a microbelly centipede, like a gigatera.
Deal with these. This is perhaps the only confusing side. This one, that's the only one that's not weird. Micro isn't an M, it's a.
You'll notice the rest of them is just the abbreviation of the first letter.
Yep.
This is a little M for milli, capital letters for mega, which is they both begin with M, remember which way around it goes. Just think milli is small, so small, if it's big, big.
That brings us to the end of our speed table drawing.
Now let's go on to estimation. Ooh. Now we're on to estimation.
There you go. It is actually in the book. It's not really a teaching thing, it's a skill. You've got to be able to do it. Basically, don't be a melon.
So estimation, as you can guess, is estimating things.
Yeah, so you just need to know relative sizes of stuff. So let's take Wayne as an example.
Am I 800 metres tall?
No, he's not. He's about 1'6".
1'6", about
six,
there.
1'7".
Average weight for a male human, about 70 to 80 kilograms.
70 to 80 kilograms, yeah.
And perhaps a little bit less for a female, about 60 kilograms.
About there. And cars, they weigh more than 500, but less than...
2 million.
2 million. It's really big, but as long as your estimation isn't ridiculous. I think the only time I've ever seen this on an exam was estimating area of someone's foot.
Yes. Obviously, you work out the area, so the first question is estimate the length. And the width, and then from that work out the area. So as long as you get these within a reasonable sort of estimate, so you don't get meter squared feet.
Yeah, because they're called crazy clown shoes. I don't like that either. They do have a sort of frame like in between this size shoe and this size shoe.
Plausible size
shoe. Plausible size shoe.
And this is all to do with when you get questions in an exam, you look at the final answer you get, is it realistic?
Yeah, you can look at it and go, in an exam they'll never give you a question that's mad.
No.
Like, you'll never have a skydiver who weighs 400 kilograms.
It just wouldn't happen.
They
use real figures in your exam.
Yeah, so. They've always been starting to check some way to think, is this right? It's like the shoe example, you can always measure your foot.
You can measure your foot in the exams, it's sneaky. About this, I reckon an average person is maybe a bit bigger, a bit smaller, whoever you are.
Yeah.
It's all to do with checking your answers and seeing if it's realistic, really. But it is a thing in the book.
So, covered it. Done.
On
to something slightly more physics-y. I think it's vectors.
Scalars and vector quantities first.
Okay.
Alright, here we go.
Scalars and vectors.
So first we ask the question, what is a scalar and what is a vector? This is true.
A scalar is a quantity that just has magnitude. Whereas a vector
has magnitude and direction. That's the difference, is the direction part.
What does that really mean when we start thinking about distance or speed?
Well, distance and speed is in both of these, except it has different names. So for scalar, we have speed.
Yeah.
That's probably what you're familiar with, is the idea of how quick you're going. On this side, we have velocity.
Ooh. And that adds the direction part.
So it is essentially the speed you're going, but in a direction. So if you're measuring in that direction, and you're going at 20 metres per second, both your speed and your velocity will be equal. However, if you pass a car going this way at 40 metres per second, it will look like they're going past you at 60 metres per second.
Because you said relative velocity.
This should be revision from GCSE. You should sort of know the difference between these.
And there is definition questions everywhere.
There's another example, which is in both, but with different names.
We have distance on this side.
And displacement on this side.
So what's the difference here, Wayne?
Well, again, Trev, it's the direction thing. Oh. I want to draw an example here of going into a supermarket.
All right, so if I come in, I want some eggs. Some eggs. Oh, I need to get milk. Oh, I've forgotten I need to get some biscuits.
You need some tea.
I need tea. I always need tea.
You need to go to the checkout.
Oh, you need to go to the checkout. And then, is it the eggs?
That one's perfect.
Yeah.
Your distance, in this case, is how far you've travelled.
Yes, I've got all of this bit. The onions, the eggs, tea.
So you pretty much walked around the whole shop here in this case. Your displacement, however, is from the point A to B.
Just where you start and finish.
So if you draw that in red, it's actually just that distance there. That is your displacement from the beginning.
So your displacement will always be less than your distance travelled.
That's correct.
Or the same. But never
more. Or the same if it's a straight line. There's other examples of scalars and vectors. So some other examples of scalars might be temperature.
Yeah. Hot. I mean, it can't be hot in the direction.
It doesn't make sense to say this is 5 degrees due east. That's just silly. Pressure.
But pressure is a confusing one, but it is a scalar.
You do sort of think as pressure is pressuring something. In something, but it's actually not. You can sort of think of it as it's all coming in on one thing. Like if you're under the water and it's all pressure on you, it all cancels out.
Yeah.
You have pressure up and pressure down, and it becomes scalar.
Yeah.
Same with density, similar thing.
Yeah. And then maybe some other examples for vectors?
Yes, we have force. If I push Triv, I'm putting a force in that direction, so force.
You've got the impulse.
Impulse. We have acceleration.
Oh.
That's an important one.
Yeah, that's a definition again comes up more often than most others.
You can accelerate and you can decelerate. You can accelerate in that direction. But if you're measuring it in this direction,
if you're slowing down, you're actually decelerating.
These are just some examples. There are more. You've got stuff like momentum, electric fields. Vectors, these ones. There's some more scalars.
Sometimes in the exam, they'll have tables and you'll have to say which one's which or what's the difference in these ones. Or
yep. There are a few mark questions worth knowing, worth noting.
Easy marks, really, if you just know stuff.
So now we're actually going to go on to using vectors with...
Yeah, some diagrams and...
Vector calculations.
Ooh!
So now we're on to vectors.
Okay. So, we have an example.
Of a pen.
Yep. Pen. We have a very heavy pen. We're going to say it weighs...
4 newtons.
Four newtons.
That's about right, really.
For a heavy pen. So we throw this pen up, I throw it up with a force of 20 metres per second.
What this really means is we've got an upwards force of 20 newtons, because that's the force Triv's supplying to push it up. But its weight is actually acting in the other direction, so it would be negative 4 newtons.
It's
opposite to the way.
So what you need to do here is add them together. But as this is a minus, it's like taking 4 away from 20. You can do it the other way around. You can say that this is the right direction and it's minus 20. But it's nicer to have positive numbers at the end. So we have
a resultant force, as it's called, of 60 newtons.
But things aren't always in one, and they're not always just doing that.
No, it's not always.
Sometimes there is corners involved.
Corners, and they turn out to be triangles.
Well, nearly always, everything ends up to be a triangle, really. So we have I go this way, and then I go this way.
That's actually equivalent to saying that. It's called the resolution of vectors. A plus B is going to equal C. Let me make this So you've got to learn your triangle rules.
Yeah, you've got all the Pythagoras ones, and you will have. It's not always a.
It's not always a right angle triangle. So you've got to use your sine rule, your cosine rule.
Trigonometry stuff.
Real trigonometry.
Oh goodness.
This is why they normally require quite good grades in maths to take physics.
Generally, yeah.
So you need it.
Yeah.
So let's actually go on to an example of vectors.
Yeah, proper vector resolution question.
We're now going to go through a worked example.
In this book.
There you go. Jeff, could you quickly read out the figures?
I can. Alright, we have a lorry's load, which is a weight of 40,000 newtons.
It's a weight, it's going to be going down like this. 40,000 newtons.
And being pulled along by a horizontal force of 15,000 newtons.
Horizontal force is 15,000 newtons.
The question asks, what is the resultant of these two forces?
That's what we were just talking about with the vectors, is that this can actually be divided up into a resultant. And this is going to be 90 degrees. If the weight goes down and this is going perfectly horizontal, you can see why. So how do we answer this question, Triv?
Well, when we have two things here, you basically use Pythagoras.
You should remember from GCSE, a squared plus b squared equals c squared. It means that this is c squared, is it going to answer
to this?
It does. Right, c squared is
18.25 times 10 to the 8 newtons. Centrifugal happens quite a lot in physics, you're used to using it.
Yeah, but it's much better than actually writing out the 8 zeros.
Yeah, in a long time. Which is the square root there.
Yep, c equals the square root of it.
Which is 4.27 times 10 to the 4. And that's our resultant, which will actually travel that way.
It would actually travel that way.
So sometimes,
instead of writing out the triangle,
the example, draw this line maybe here, and then this would be, it'd be now going down there.
It would. Overall. Sometimes you might actually be asked to actually calculate the angle here that it's going down in. But in this case, we were just working out this, so it makes a difference.
Yeah. So if you write up another example of a triangle, then we can go through what trig you actually need to know.
Yes, Pythagoras is pretty basic, but sometimes, like we said, it's not a right-angled triangle. And even if it is, sometimes you can't use this because you don't know
the sides. Yeah, so
what do we use then?
Wow. Okay, and here we have a triangle, rather naked at the moment.
If we imagine a situation where we know this side and we know this angle, and we might be asked to work out this side, or even this angle.
Yeah.
How can you do that? Because you can't apply Pythagoras, even though it's a right-angled triangle. You need to know two sides for that.
Yeah, so we have to use something called trigonometry of triangles.
Yes, so
I start drawing the triangle, start labelling things. You can call this thing theta, which is often used to denote angles.
It's a Greek letter just to represent an angle.
And look here.
Okay. So what we have here is we have the angles of the triangle. This A represents this angle here, which is unknown in this example. B would represent this, and C would represent this. So to label it up, side A is the opposite side to angle A. So A, B, B, C, C, if you can see where that's coming from. So what's the relationship between all these things? We have, again, this should be from GCSE. I'll just write it up anyway.
The way to remember it is Sokotoa.
Sokotoa.
Yeah. So you have sine
of theta
equals opposite over the hypotenuse.
So that means the sine of the angle theta would equal the opposite side to theta over the hypotenuse of the triangle.
Yeah.
Soc cap.
So the cosine of the angle.
But hey.
Is equal to the adjacent over the hypotenuse.
So same thing, but the adjacent over the hypotenuse equals the cos of that angle.
Yeah.
And we finally we have
toa, which is tan theta, which is the opposite of the adjacent.
So now we're going to actually go through an example with a number where we know one side, we know one angle, and going to work out either or both of these.
Okay, so draw another triangle here.
Same triangle, which has been drawn quicker. And now we're getting numbers, it's going to be a little bit crazy.
So what side are we going to have, Wayne?
Let's say we have B in this side. We actually have the hypotenuse length.
Okay, so we're going to say we have a hypotenuse length of 50.
50. This could be centimetres, this could be millimetres.
It doesn't really matter.
As long as the units are the same. And an angle of 72 degrees.
Okay.
Alright, now we're going to actually use some real maths, so hats off.
Getting serious now.
Alright. So we have the hypotenuse, we have this angle. So first let's just label up sides A, B and C. Yeah. I think that's always a good start for me in exams.
Definitely. So we have B here. So A over here. And C will be there.
Alright. So we know the hypotenuse and we know this. Let's just say we're trying to work out side C. For the moment, what does C equal? Well, C is opposite the angle, right? And we know the hypotenuse. So we need an equation that links the angle, the opposite side, and the hypotenuse. So which one's it going to be, Trivett?
Well, so... Oh, it's so!
Ah.
So if you write that equation out,
sine of this angle, which is 72 in this example, the sine of this angle equals this opposite side over the hypotenuse.
We have sine of 72.
Sine of 72 equals C, which we're trying to find out, over 50.
Now we just need to rearrange this equation.
Yes.
So C equals 50 of sine of the angle we have, 72. So if we would like to get out your very expensive. Don't have your very expensive calculator.
I think we might have Triv's expensive calculator for once, instead of using mine. Guest star and all that.
I know. Do you know how much I paid for it?
I don't know. How much did you pay for it, Triv? Was it £20?
Oh, no, more than that.
£30?
More than that.
£40?
More than that.
£50?
It was 50 quid! 50 quid!
Oh, my goodness me. This is mine.
It's much nicer in every single way apart from being
exactly the same.
The same calculator, yeah. So if we have 50
times sine 72, we get this side,
which is 47.6. That's to one decimal place. It's not quite that, but it's pretty close.
So now, let's just say, instead of working out this, just ignore we've worked this out. Yeah. In the question, we might have been asked to work this one out instead. Or you take out the same sort of method. We know this angle, we know the hypotenuse, and this one is adjacent.
It's right next to, but isn't the hypotenuse at the end.
So, Trivett, which of these equations links the hypotenuse, the adjacent, and the angle we have?
Could it be ka, which is cosine of the angle equals the adjacent over the hypotenuse?
Yes, it is. I hope you can see that we know this, and we're trying to work out this.
Maybe you want in the exam, you might want to label this the adjacent and the hypotenuse and the opposite. If you get a bit stuck on trigonometry, it might be easier.
Yes. So, again, we do the same sort of thing. We bump down our figures. We have cos 72.
We do.
Equals the adjacent, which we're trying to find out, which happens to be labelled A in this case, A for adjacent, over the hypotenuse, which we know is 50. Same thing again, side by 50.
So you get 50 cosine of 72. So again, we'll get the very exciting, expensive calculator out.
How much was this calculator, Trivett? Was it £45, if we say?
Oh, more than that way.
What, 48?
Oh,
it was 50 quid!
Oh my goodness!
Alright.
So 50 times cos 72 is A.
It is an A, that makes A 15.5.
Now vectors are an essential part of your A-level course. A lot of things can be represented as a vector And nearly every time it will come out as a triangle,
it
just
will
like
do.
This.
You'll make triangles, and I think most it's used for is stuff going down a slope, which we'll get onto in a while.
On an inclined plane.
Ooh. Way it comes into account then, goodness.
So these new equations, you're going to have to know off by heart, like you said, Sokotoa.
Yeah.
I learned the example, sun on head causes a headache, take one aspirin. Whatever works for you, you can remember these.
You just remember your triangle, and then apply it.
It was funny on the head. So let's give it a go.
Alright, let's do it. Okay, go.